Now we will be doing about momentum. If there are two objects here, these are two objects. One is of weight 20 gram, another is of weight 50 gram. If we consider it to be an object of 20 gram, 50 gram, and there is a plain glass surface below, and we allow these two objects to fall on the glass, we will find that the impact of the 20 gram is lesser, but the impact of the 50 gram will be more. Because the more the mass, the more the impact. Again, if we have two weights here, 20 gram and 20 gram, one is placed on the glass surface and the other is placed at a height of 50 meters and allow them to drop. You will find that the one which is at a height of 50 meters will have more impact, because this shows that it is traveling with a certain velocity. So that means the velocity will give it more impact. So momentum ultimately depends upon, that is, the impact is depending upon the mass and the velocity. So this force, which is possessed by the body due to the combined effect of this mass and velocity, we call it as the momentum. And if I denote P as the momentum, then P is equal to M into V, where M is the mass and V is the velocity. I come into the Newton's second law of motion. If I have a car whose battery is running out and I ask some people to push it, right, by applying a force, and after a particular time, then only it will increase in acceleration and speed. Force necessary to change the momentum, it depends on the time rate at which the momentum changes. So we come to this definition, which states of Newton's second law of motion, which says that the rate of change of momentum is directly proportional to the applied unbalanced force and takes place in the same direction in which the force is applied. Right? It takes place in the same direction in which the force is applied. Let us look into the mathematical expression to understand this more better. If I have a body here of mass m and the initial velocity is u, and if I apply a force F on it, after time t seconds, the velocity that it will be achieved is V. So initial momentum will be mass into velocity, that is M into U. Final velocity will be mass into velocity, that is M into V. The change in momentum will be final momentum minus the initial momentum, that is MV minus MU. This change in momentum is in t seconds. The change in momentum in 1 second, that is the rate and change of momentum, will be mv minus mu divided by this t. Or I can take this m common and write v minus u within brackets over t. This v minus u over t is nothing but it is the acceleration, because v minus u by t is the rate of change of velocity. That's why in place of v minus u by t, I write a. So this change in moment, rate of change of momentum is equal to ma. By Newton's second law stated that the force is directly proportional to the rate of change of momentum. That is, force is directly proportional to ma, because now we know the rate of change of momentum is ma. If I change the sign of proportionality and I write equal sign here, to change proportionality to equal sign, I have to multiply with a constant k. And if m is equal to 1, that is the mass is 1, and if the acceleration is 1, and the force is 1 Newton, then we will see that this k is reduced to 1. And putting the value of k is 1 in this equation here, I will get F is equal to 1 into m into a. That is, F is equal to m into a. Finally, I will come to the saying that force is the product of mass into acceleration, which is a Newton's second law, mathematically derived. Now let us look at the derivation of the first law from the second law. The second law of Newton, just now I saw that it is F is equal to ma. A, the acceleration, is nothing but v minus u divided by t. This is the acceleration. Taking t to the other side, I will write F into t, this is equal to m, into v minus u will remain this side. If F is equal to 0, if the force is 0, then this entire quantity becomes 0, That means mv minus u will be equal to 0. Mv minus u is equal to 0. Mv minus mu, this is also equal to 0. M minus mu, take it to the other side. It will become mv is equal to mu. Mm cancel. What you get is v is equal to u. This v is equal to u shows that the final velocity is equal to the initial velocity. And that means the velocity is remaining the same. If u is equal to 0, then v also will be equal to 0. That means if the final initial velocity is 0, final velocity is 0 means if it is at rest, it will continue to be at rest. If it is in motion, it will continue to be in motion. This is actually the first law. The statement shows that it is a first law. So from the second law, we reach to the first law. This is how we derive. Then let us look into the units of force. Force we know is mass into acceleration. Mass, the unit is kg, SI unit. SI unit of acceleration, we have seen the first chapter, is meter per second square. Combine these two, we get kg meter per second square. This kg meter per second square is nothing but 1 newton. This is the absolute unit of force, 1 newton. Let us look into the other unit. Force, again I write here, is mass into acceleration. Acceleration, the unit here is 9.8 meter per second square. I take all these units together, put the quantity in front, 9.8 into kg meter per second square. 9.8, this kg meter per second square, just now we saw it is 1 newton. So I write here as newton. So 9.8 newton, this is the gravitational unit. Now let us look into something which is called as impulse of force. According to the second law, F is equal to ma, that is F is equal to m into v minus u by t. If I multiply this t to the other side, that is F into t, this is force into time, is equal to m into v minus u, that is mv minus mu, that is force into time is equal to the change in momentum. This is nothing but force into time, very, very short time. If you apply force for a very, very short time, that is called as the impulse. So this impulse is force into time, which is equal to the change in momentum. Let us look lastly into Newton's third law of motion. Newton's third law of motion states that, it's a very famous saying, to every action, there is an equal and opposite reaction. That is, if a ball is placed on the ground, it exerts a force on the ground. And due to this, due to its weight, it exerts a force on the ground. Now, the ground also exerts equal and opposite reaction. The force of the ball is balanced by the reaction of the ground on the ball. And that's how the ball remains in position. There are more examples given in the text. The last thing given in the text is laws of conservation of momentum. In any given system, when two bodies interact, okay, there is no external force which is acting on them, then we see that the total momentum of all the bodies is conserved. Very good example is given in your book about this. You can see some more examples.